Hello, and welcome to The Banker's Secret to Permanent Family Wealth. I'm John Cummuta. I've been a best-selling personal finance author and seminar leader for nearly three decades. I've taught over 3 million people worldwide, including 13 Tony Robbins Wealth Mastery events. Now, I want to share just three points with you in this brief presentation. The first is the problem, the primary reason why you're not on your way to financial independence. Number two, the solution, an extraordinary system that completely solves the problem. And number three, your first step, what to do next. So we'll start with the problem. Here's where you want to be. You'd love to be on what we call the wealth curve. That's compound interest. That's where you're putting money into an account that's earning a return, and you just put money in on a regular basis, and it continues to compound, and the interest earns interest. It's magnificent. Albert Einstein called it the greatest invention he'd ever seen. But that's not what happens. What typically happens is somewhere after you've started saving for a year, two, three, four, five, something comes along and you need to take some money out. So you fall off the wealth curve temporarily, but then you say, oh, you know what, I have to get right back to this. So you start saving again, but you took some of the money out that was in there compounding. And so you'll notice that the growth on the solid green curve intersects the wealth line far lower than the dashed line will eventually intersect the wealth line. The dashed line here is the uninterrupted wealth curve, as if you had not taken any money out. But here's what really happens. You notice the gold jagged line down at the bottom here. That's you take money out to buy a car, and then somewhere down the line you have kids, or you have a wedding, you got to take some money out for that. Then you have children, and they come with their own expenses. Then maybe out there you want to take a vacation, possibly buy that little summer home or a condo or something. And you see, all the way out through life, you keep falling off that wealth curve for reasonable purchases, but they keep taking you off of the wealth curve. They keep taking you out of that constant continuing compounding. So it ends up taking away your ability to build significant wealth. Look out there where the gold jagged line intersects the wealth line. Now we've used age 80 here. That's arbitrary. People are living longer, so they're putting off retirement. But you could move that to 60. You could move it to 70. It doesn't really matter, because wherever you move it, these lines will intersect the wealth line at a lower point for the gold jagged line, better for the red line where you took it out one time, and the best is the undisturbed wealth curve line where your money is not touched. It continually grows. It only and always grows. That's what we call the wealth curve. But life happens, and that puts us down on the jagged sawtooth curve of death that we show at the bottom of this illustration. But don't kick yourself, because it's not really totally your fault. We are constantly being seduced by advertising and media and merchants to use our money in ways that are not in our own best interests. And that's what constantly ends up pulling us off the wealth curve. And so we don't do the disciplined saving and preparing that we should do that would keep us on that wealth curve, so we would have that nice big nest egg when we get out there. To make matters worse, we don't save in a place that really has a wealth curve. We save, in most cases, in qualified plans, which are, in most cases, invested in what I call the shock market. This is not a wealth curve. Again, it's a sawtooth curve of death. And if you look at the two humps that and the valleys that follow them with the red line across, that was 2000 and 2008, the crashes from the dot-com and then the real estate bubble in 2008, each of which took about half of people's portfolios when they failed. Now, could you stand to have half of your portfolio disappear before or after or during retirement? Could you afford that? Could you continue to live, or would you have to go back to work? Think about that. The repercussions are enormous. Now we're up here in a higher place, but these are cyclical. It's going to happen again and again out in the future. And I call that timing risk. The timing is always going to be bad for you. Either it's going to take away a significant piece of your portfolio before you retire, or right at the point when you want to retire. I know people who intended to retire in 2008 who are still working because half of their nest egg was taken away. It's not what they planned. Well, that happens periodically, but let's say they made it and they retired in 2007. And then the stock market crashed. Well, if they had their money in a 401k, that was still their nest egg. They were taking out a certain amount of money periodically, but can they continue taking that much out? No. All of a sudden, their entire retirement picture changes because the market just decides to take half of it away or some significant portion. This is not how you do it. Qualified plans aren't savings plans. They are gambling accounts. Unfortunately, most of your income is lost before it gets anywhere near the wealth curve. First of all, on average, we lose about 28% of our income to taxes. Then after taxes, more than a third of the remaining income goes to interest payments for the average middle American household. That's more than half of your income gone before you ever get your hands on it, or any that you can use. 42%, on average, goes to living expenses for most American households, and that's just the cost of day-to-day living and doing the things we need to do, which leaves, in this case, about 5% for saving, which really is not enough to put you on and keep you on that nice wealth curve that turns vertical out there in the later years. So that is a serious problem. And because of this problem, according to the Employee Benefits Research Institute and the Institute for Retirement Security, 92% of American households are not on a trajectory to ever be able to completely retire at anything close to their working lifestyle. Let that sink in. 92% can never retire completely at anything close to their working lifestyle. So what do they end up doing? Well, just go to Costco or Sam's Club and see who's handing you food samples. These are people in their 70s and 80s. You think that was their financial plan? No, they cannot live on what they ended up with. Social Security pays about $1,239 a month on average. Who can live on $1,239 a month? Nobody. If you don't have a pension and you have something in your 401k, but nowhere near enough to be able to give you a regular income for an indefinite period that would keep you able to pay all the expenses you pay now, you are in this 92%. So this presentation becomes very important to you. So what if I could show you an extraordinary money system where your money would only grow and never have a correction or a loss? A system that would let you keep the 34.5% you're currently losing to interest on average. A system that would compound that 34.5% interest with interest in your account. A system that would reduce your taxes. A system that could pay off all of your debts. A system that would dramatically reduce financial risk. A system that would eliminate qualified plan restrictions like contribution limitations, loan restrictions, and of course it's invested in the stock market. And then there are those silly withdrawal limitations if you're not 59 and a half. This is not a savings plan. A system that would let you enjoy unrestricted use and control of your money 24/7, 365. A system that would protect your money from creditors, judgments, and lawsuits. A system that would reduce or eliminate income taxes on your nest egg, capital gains on your nest egg, and estate taxes on your nest egg. A system that would assure your wealth plan would succeed even if you're disabled or even if you die before you complete it. If you could get a system that could do all that, you'd pay less to taxes. You could reduce your interest payments to zero. Of course, the 42% living expenses is still 42% to live every day. But because you're not paying all that money to interest, you can now save around 30% of your money. And that can put you on and keep you on the wealth curve. So what is this wonderful solution? Well, it's a golden box. What this box represents is that you have to change who profits from the use of your money. You need to change who controls the use of your money. In other words, you need to change boxes. These are just boxes in the big global money pool. Brokerage firms, banks, insurance companies. We get all hung up on the labels over the front door of these institutions, but they don't. They just slosh around big piles of money to each other whenever they need it. They understand they're just boxes in the money pool. What happens here? Forget the box labels for a second. You go to the bank, you put deposits in, you go to the bank, you take money out in a withdrawal or a loan, and it's just a box in the money pool with money going in, money going out. You put deposits in your brokerage firm, you make contributions, then you take money out in retirement or a withdrawal from your 401k or IRA. It's just another money box with money going in, money going out. Same thing with the insurance company. We put in premiums, we can make withdrawals, we get benefits whenever one of those claims are made. So money in, money out. But if you can forget the labels over the boxes, then you can do something magical. You can change boxes and become your own bank. If you can allow yourself to expand your thinking for a little bit right here, you can take some of the important and expensive functions of a bank and move them to an insurance company, and things work out a lot better for you. We call it a private family bank. It's a specially designed and modified whole life contract with a mutual life insurance company. Here's the magic of this. You put money in. The insurance company calls them premiums. We call them deposits or contributions to your wealth account. They go into the insurance policy, and the way we modify it, most of those dollars go right into what's called cash value inside that whole life policy from the very first premium payment. So you are building cash in a big way. That is your bank. And it continues to grow at right now, right around 4.5%. Tax deferred. That's your private family bank. Now you're just putting money in regular premiums, and the insurance company is putting money in with interest and dividends, and it's all just growing, and it's never disturbed. It continues to grow uninterrupted for the rest of your natural life. Now, what about using that money? Well, there's a line there, and on the other side of that line, you see the insurance company and you, and you're doing what's called policy loans and repayments to use money inside your policy anytime you want for whatever you want while it still stays in your policy, growing with interest and dividends, tax deferred. This is magical. Let's buy a car to show you how it can work. Now, there are three common ways that you could buy a car. You could borrow cash from the bank or from the finance office at the dealership, which is really a front for the bank, or you could save up and pay cash for the car, right? But there's a third option. You could finance that car purchase through your private family bank. Now, let's look at these one at a time. If you borrow from a bank, you'll notice that we're using a $30,000 car as an example. You go to the bank, you get 30 grand, and then over the next 5 years, you pay back roughly $6,000 a year. So you pay it back, and you work your way back up to zero. But about that time, you say, hey, you know, I think I'd like to trade this in and get a new car. So you go back, $30,000 in the hole, and then over the next 5 years, you make payments, and you work your way back to zero. I think we'd all agree this is not optimal. I mean, the car, if it's a $30,000 car plus interest, it's going to cost you $30,000 plus several more thousands in interest. Even if it says it's 0% interest, I could show you the math that would prove that there it's actually 6 to 8% interest, but let's not even go there. It's going to cost you something to use the bank's money. Well, then the other option is, of course, save up and pay cash for the car. So you see here, over 5 years, you save up $6,000 a year, and you've got $30,000 in your savings account. So what do? You go down to the dealership, and you write a check, and bam, you own the car. And hey, you have no car payments, right? And you didn't pay any interest, right? Well, let's think about that for a second. First of all, if you intend to buy another car after this one, like you did with the previous example of the financed cars, you're going to have to start saving up again so that 5 years later you have enough to get another car. So you really do have a car payment. It's the payment back into your savings account to be prepared to buy the next car. What about, did it cost you any interest? Well, at your 5, you were earning interest on $30,000. Now, if it was in a bank, you were earning not much interest, but you were earning something. And when you liquidated that and it went to zero, you stopped earning interest. So there was an interest cost there. So there is an interest cost and payments to using cash to buy the vehicle. So how would it be better using a private family bank? Well, let's look. Here you see the little red and blue bars down at the bottom. Those are simply condensed versions of the red and blue bars we used to show a financed purchase and a cash purchase in the previous slide. They're made smaller so that we can have a lot of vertical room to show you what happens in your private family bank. What you're essentially doing is the same thing the cash buyer did, but instead of saving in a regular bank, you're saving in your private family bank, and that cash value is shown in the green bars. So you'll notice in the beginning, it looks kind of similar, but watch those green bars start to take off, and then as you get out there into the future, what does that look like? It looks kind of like a wealth curve. Even though you are periodically pulling $30,000 out to use it, it's still growing in your cash value undisturbed. And that shows you the net cash value growth. It's growing like the wealth curve, even though you're using the money. The magic is you get to use your money two different ways at the same time. The money that you put in to your cash value only and always continually grows tax deferred. The money never comes out of here. When you go get your 30 grand, you're getting it from the insurance company. You're not getting it out of your cash value. They're not taking it from your cash value. So interest and dividends are always being calculated on that ever increasing balance, the wealth curve. Meanwhile, you're doing all your car loans and repayments back to the insurance company, and that is not disturbing your wealth curve. So you can see what that means. You can stop falling off of your jagged wealth curve of death down on the bottom. You don't even have to be on the red one. You can be on the green one that gets you to the best possible place, because even though you are making the purchases that are shown down on the jagged blue line of death, your money is inside your private family bank cash value, so it is following the green dashed line. No other financial tool or account can do this. Now, let's use an example. We call them Tom and Mary, and they have a private family bank, and they're young. And I have a few clients who are smart enough to start at this age, but we'll just use them as an example because it gives us a nice long timeline to see what's possible. So they decide to put $10,000 in for just 4 years into their private family bank, and that totals $40,000 in initial premiums. Then they use their bank every 5 years, just like we showed in the previous example, to buy a $30,000 car. So what happens? They make car payments back to their private family bank, back to the insurance company, and they decide to pay $872 a month. That is the $539 regular loan payment at the 5% interest rate the insurance company charges, plus $333 for the minimum premium ongoing, what's called the base premium, into their private family bank. Now, this is a specific type of design. We have many different designs we can use to build your private family bank should you want one, but this is just what Tom and Mary decided to do. So let's see how it worked out for them. Beginning at age 70, they decided to work till age 70 because they felt good and they enjoyed what they were doing. At age 70, they started taking $30,000 a year out of their private family bank to supplement their retirement income. They're getting Social Security and whatever else they, you know, maybe something from their work. But they have an extra $30,000 a year that they can take out of their bank tax-free, and they will not pay these back. They're not paying this back. This money is coming out and they're going to spend it, and they're going to spend it guilt-free. Now, by age 85, after they've continued doing this for 15 years, let's just take a snapshot and see where they're at. By age 85, including the $30,000 for 15 years that they used to supplement their retirement, plus the money they took out to buy cars, they took out a total of $743,458 from their private family bank. And at that point, there would still be 26,000 $876 in cash value, and a $189,113 death benefit. So if you put all those numbers together, the total private family bank value to their family will be $932,571. And they only capitalized it with $40,000 in initial premiums plus $333 a month with their car payments when they were making car payments prior to retirement. Now let's look at an example of using the private family bank to pay off your debts. This is a couple, a real couple, this is an actual example, who had $250,000 in debt. Well, it took them, using the system inside their private family bank, 11 years to completely pay off their debts, including their house. And at the end of that, they had $250,000 of cash in their private family bank, plus the value of all the assets, including their house, that they paid off. Let's invest through your private family bank. This is a real example of a real business loan made by someone with a private family bank. They knew a baker who wanted to build a new, bigger bakery to serve their shops in the various neighborhoods of a major city. And so they offered this person that if they would lend the bakery $100,000 for their building project, the bakery promised to pay them back at 12% annual interest for 7 years. Now let's compare doing this deal from money we might have in a regular bank versus money we have in our private family bank. If we start with the regular bank, we take the $100,000 out and we give it to the baker. And over the course of 7 years, they pay us back $138,626 after taxes. It's actually more than that, but once we pay the taxes, we're left with $138,626. And that's pretty good. It's a 39% gain. Not bad. But let's see how it works out using a private family bank as the source of those funds. We take the $100,000 out. Now, it's not coming out of our cash value. It's coming directly from the insurance company. We lend it to the baker. And then after the 7 years, we realize a total gain after taxes of $170,047. That's a 70% gain. And there are no taxes on the gains inside the policy. There's some tax on the gains outside the policy, but not on the gains inside the policy. But 70% is better than 39%. $170,000 is better than $138,000. Let's build a wealth system with our private family bank. And we start with protection. Your private family banking policy effectively has two banks. Your cash value, which is the money you can access and use anytime through the direct loan from the insurance company function, that's your bank. The death benefit is your loved one's bank. So you're actually building both of them simultaneously. They both grow every year during the course of your policy. And so you have money you can use and spend guilt-free knowing that there is something significant left for your loved ones. Whereas if this money was in, let's say, an IRA, and you spent it down to zero, your heirs would get zero from that. But here they get the death benefit. If we go up a level, you could finance yourself with your private family bank. It could be your emergency fund. You could use it for purchasing cars, as we looked at. You could use it for financing vacations, remodeling your home, anything you might normally borrow for. Then you could finance your family. Once you've covered your needs and there's money in your bank, finance your family. Your children and grandchildren can borrow student loans from your private family bank. You can lend home down payment money. You can finance their car purchases for them. Anything you're comfortable lending to them for and having confidence that they're going to pay you back. But if they get into trouble, you know, you're not going to be like a real bank and report them to the credit bureau. So this is just better for the family. That's why we call it a private family bank. If you want to step it up even higher, you can finance your business. If you have a business or you want to start a business, you can use money from your private family bank to start and grow a business. You could use it to finance inventory and equipment, anything your business might borrow money for. And then you could finance others. You can actually function like a real bank. You can lend to anyone you trust to repay you for anything they want to borrow for. Now, you should use proper paperwork and get collateral where appropriate, but you can actually be the bank. Now, how does it become permanent wealth? Well, this is just an example, but when you have the death benefit piece added on to your savings, that death benefit can go down to generations below you, and you teach them how the private family bank works. So if you're leaving a death benefit to someone, you can say, use a portion of this or all of this to fund your own private family bank and cascade your death benefit down a generation or two and teach them to fund a private family bank with it for the generations below them. And you can actually build a system where each generation is wealthier than previous generations because that money is snowballing as it moves down through the generations. It's all about training them and then just execute it. Now, you may be thinking by this point, you know, I should look into this. Well, your first step is to get with the private family banking agent who invited you to watch this presentation. They can answer your questions and design a custom illustration for your consideration. Now, this illustration is not anything binding. It has no obligations to it. It's just what it sounds like, an illustration of how your private family bank policy would work for you year by year by year for the rest of your life. It will show you the actual numbers for your cash value, your death benefit, and everything year by year. And it's just something for you to examine and ask questions about and help you make a decision as to whether or not you want to move forward. If you decide to move forward, they will help you start your private family bank. Now, you'll notice that you is bolded here. Why? Because you decide. We never sell private family banks to people. We help them start private family banks because normally they come to the inescapable conclusion that this is exactly what they need for their family. And your private family banking agent will be available to assist you after you have your policy in using your private family bank. You should also ask about our Banker Secret to Permanent Family Wealth book. This ebook is available for immediate download. You can read it on any e-reader, smartphone, tablet, or computer, and it goes into much greater detail than I was able to in this presentation. You'll see how a private family bank could work for you with clear illustrations and specific numbers, and you'll see why a private family bank is your best hope to safely and dependably build retirement wealth. And as I said, I was brief with this. Now you can talk to your private family banking agent. Thank you for your time, and we look forward to serving you and those you love.